So the first thing I want to show you is this. It's an oil well, the first of its kind. The first well that pumped oil out of the ground. And guess what? It was in the United States. A man named Edwin Drake built the very first oil well. And as you can imagine, this was a game changer. So by the 1920s, the United States was the world's leading industrial power due to a number of factors. Number one, we're a large country. The United States is about as big as Western Europe. So think about that. We call Napoleon creepy for trying to conquer Western Europe. We call Hitler evil. Well, of course, he did try to kill millions of people, but we also called him evil and tried to stop him for conquering Western Europe. When we conquered the United States, we conveniently called it Manifest Destiny and considered ourselves justified in building an empire larger than Julius Caesar had. Interesting, right? So, now we reap the benefits of our conquest because we have a nation wealthy in natural resources. That's one point. Secondly, the government tended to support business, particularly big business, at all times, even to the detriment of the American worker. And then finally, a rapidly growing urban population. A cheap labor force. So you need several things to make innovation work. These are called the factors of production. You need land, you need labor, you need capital. We had all three of those in plenty. The first one I want to talk about is oil, because it's certainly one of the more important technological revolutions that we'll be talking about. Oil has been around, well, we don't know exactly, for millions of years perhaps. It just bubbles out of the ground in some places. In fact, Native Americans had been using it for medicine, for fuel, for tens of thousands of years. However, it was in 1859 that Edwin Drake first used a steam engine, as you saw in the picture previously, to drill for oil. And this led to the explosion of the petroleum and refining industry. In fact, up until the Second World War, the United States was the world's leading producer of oil. The second one I want to talk about is steel. Steel also proved to be a game changer. And there's a number of reasons this revolution occurred in the United States. Number one, abundant raw materials. You need a couple things to make steel. First off, you need coal, because coal can burn at a hot enough temperature to melt raw iron. Because all steel is refined iron. Secondly, you need an abundance of raw iron. Well, thankfully, since we have such a big country, we have plenty of sources for raw iron. But secondly, there's a major change in the production of steel that occurred in the late 1800s in the United States. A man named Henry Bessemer figured out a process to refine iron into steel in large quantities cheaply. It's called the Bessemer process, that if you inject air into molten iron, It can quickly remove carbon to make steel. Later, the open hearth process also began the recycling of scrap metal or raw materials. There's still a market for scrap metal. There are people who wander around Henderson County looking for scrap metal because they know they can sell it to refineries, because they know refineries will buy it. Because of the open hearth process, it can be melted down and remade and repurposed. So now that steel can be produced far more cheaply than previously, it can be used practically for railroads, it can be used practically for farmers and barbed wire, and even farm machines. Whereas previously you had to be very wealthy to afford the products of a blacksmith. I mean, swords were owned by the very wealthy because it was expensive to make fine steel. Now, steel was being used in skyscrapers, on train tracks, and on farms across the country and world. This is a smelter. They're huge in many cases. There's been one on the old Acosta site in Brevard since I've lived here. It is as tall as the first story of this building. It can melt down raw iron in large quantities. Air is injected through the bottom, as you can see, and large quantities of iron can be refined into steel at once. And so today we're talking about the age of inventions and how these new technologies changed the landscape and changed people's lives and even the way that we work. And so in this little video that you're seeing, you can get a glimpse of how a light bulb works. So what you're watching is a filament, a little piece of tungsten metal, which is being heated up with electricity. And then just for the purposes of demonstration, I wanted to show you one blowing out. Because the problem with the light bulb was the question of what type of metal can take heating and reheating, heating and reheating. Because if you know anything about metal, you know that once it's been heated and cooled, it becomes brittle and breaks. Next time your board, start playing with a paper clip. You can bend it, and of course it will eventually break. It's the same process. The question is how to find a type of metal that won't become brittle and break after being heated and cooled. Thomas Edison once said, in addition to discovering how to make the light bulb, I found thousands of ways not to make the light bulb. He tried and tried and tried. But the point is, he continued to try. He tried every metal he could think of. And in the end, tungsten proved to be the effective metal. Not only did he patent the light bulb, the incandescent light bulb, he also created an electrical grid. Now, to be fair, he wasn't the first to do so. I'm sure you've heard of Tesla and his ideas that were revolutionary for the electrical grid, ideas that perhaps could have even led to cheaper and more abundant electricity for all. Well, Thomas Edison borrowed on many of these ideas and developed the first electrical grid in the United States. And his company became a household name. And obviously, electricity was a major game changer when it became available in homes, for appliances, in factories, which now no longer have to locate near moving water. And this is going to allow for the rapid growth of industry. So here's Thomas Edison with his most famous invention. The next invention I want to talk about is the typewriter. I know this one is perhaps not as exciting, but when Christopher Sholes invented the typewriter, it proved to be a game changer as well. The typewriter was first invented in 1867, and this revolutionized the way that office work was conducted. I'm sure you all are well aware that you can type much faster than you can write by hand. I can type almost as fast as a person can speak, but it takes me forever to write a document. I certainly believe that handwriting notes is a more effective way to implant facts into the memory because it takes more time. You have to concentrate more on what you write by hand. But of course, the effectiveness of a typewriter is that you can produce written documents far more quickly. It increases efficiency and it revolutionized the way that office work was conducted. But the next invention I want to talk about was also certainly a game changer, the telephone. And you're watching a silent film here showing how the Alexander Graham Bell telephone works. This silent film was made in 1927 to demonstrate how these phones worked. Alexander Graham Bell was the first to develop a successful form of synchronous audio communication. Asynchronous communication had already been developed. The telegraph, Samuel F.B. Morse, had developed the telegraph years prior. But it was very limited in what it could do. It could transmit electronic signals, and if you did so in a pattern, you could communicate. But Alexander Graham Bell improved on this invention, as you're seeing, and this revolutionized communication. People can now talk instantly to one another across great distances. And so here's a picture of an early telephone. As you can see, they were limited in their functions. There's no button for Gmail or Facebook. I know, how did they survive? But it was a game changer. Instant synchronous communication. Some argue the First World War might never have happened had it not been for this device, and we'll get to that later. So industrialization is going to change a lot of things. Number one, it makes the world of work easier. I can't imagine having to produce what all I've created for you by hand. Ugh. I would far rather type it. It also improves the world of work, increases efficiency, which translates to a better standard of living. Even us, the working poor. Yes, I are the working poor. Even us. We live like kings. If you think about just 200 years ago, we live like kings. That's progress that has finally trickled down to all of us. Workers can now be consumers. Even though we are the working poor, I can still obsess about the Nintendo Switch and how someday I'm going to get one. I was just looking at it last night. so I'm trying to save up. But I can save up. That's the point. Workers can be consumers. But then finally, and the next clip I want to watch, or I want to show you, is one of A&E's top 100 films of all time. It's a clip from a movie called Metropolis. And it's about these revolutions in technology. Some say it's the first sci-fi film. And the reason I want to show it to you is because the word robot was coined. It's a Czech term, Czechoslovakia. It's a Czech term to describe slave, wage slave. Because some say that these new technologies like the assembly line reduce the value of human workers. And I'll let you decide for yourself. Thank you. first, before we get into the corrupt side of American industry, let's talk about the benefits of technology. I don't know if you heard, but was it Time Warner and AT&T have just merged, raising concerns about a modern-day monopoly? And many of these concerns date back to the historical reality that was the monopolies of the railroads and the banks and steel and coal and oil and things like that. And these lessons that we'll learn from history in this chapter will hopefully help you to understand the concerns that we should have about mergers of major media conglomerates like Time Warner and AT&T. Now, railroads, several positive benefits. They make local transit or shipping of goods possible. They also facilitate westward expansion. Not everybody is a Daniel Boone that can just hop on an oxbow cart and man up and travel thousands of miles on the Oregon Trail. Most of us would prefer to be able to buy a ticket and ship our goods and our families out west. Now, the government facilitated this migration with land grants, with low-cost loans to railroads, giving railroads every benefit to help them settle the West, because this would help develop our country. Now, by 1859, if you think about it, by the start of the Civil War, railroads had already been built west of the Mississippi River. In fact, by 1869, the first transcontinental railroad had been completed, meaning that by 1869, you could buy a ticket and you could ride on a train all the way across the country and go to California without taking the risk that the Donner Party faced, without possibly dying of exposure or attacked by natives or freezing to death trying to cross the Rockies. You could buy a ticket and just ride the train. So with a new technology like this, there's really a romance to it, the excitement of it, and the possibilities that it provides. You know, railroads offered cheap land to settlers who were moving out west, a chance for adventure, the opportunity to start completely over again, and a fresh start. If you lost everything in one of these economic panics, or you lost your job, or maybe you're a freed slave and you need to start over, and you just scrape together enough money for a rail ticket, that's all you need to start a whole new life. Now, railroads provided opportunities, jobs, for people from all backgrounds. People were coming from all over the world to work on these railroads. Chinese immigrants, Hispanic Americans, Irish settlers, people from all over the world were coming and getting jobs on the railroads. Many people who had fought in the Civil War were able to find work building these railroads. And it was the creation of a massive, unprecedented transportation infrastructure. There were some downsides to this. Working on the railroad was extremely dangerous. I don't know if you were watching the clip at the end. It showed a railroad going through an old tunnel. Digging those tunnels was a rather dangerous affair. And I want to tell you the story of Phineas Gage. And it's okay if you've already heard it. You'll often hear this story in psychology classes. Phineas Gage was a railroad worker. And he built tracks in the old way. He hammered spikes into rock with a steel hammer. And when he would hammer these spikes into the rock, they would pull the spikes out, they would place dynamite deep in the rock, and they would blow it up, of course everybody at a safe distance, and then they would continue digging. They would remove the rubble, and then they would drill in more spikes, and you can find these old holes in rail beds all throughout the Southeast. You know, if you go exploring in the woods, you can find where old train tracks are, and you can find where they crossed riverbeds or expanses of granite, and you can figure that out by finding these old holes. Well, one day, Phineas Gage was digging and drilling one of these holes into the mountain, and there was a charge blast on the other side of the mountain, and no one had warned the workers on the other side. Well, when the explosion went off, it created reverberations under the ground, like a mini earthquake, and it shot the spike out of the rock, went through his head, and came out the other side. Now, most people die of a wound like that, but not Phineas Gage. He was a lucky man. It actually removed the front part of his brain, shot all the way through his skull, and the doctors have on record where they were able to touch their fingers inside the man's brain. Well, Phineas Gage survived. He went on to live a not quite normal life. You see, he had been lobotomized. The frontal lobe of his brain had been removed. And psychologists have done numerous studies on this man, learning about what this part of the brain does, because this man survived without that part of the brain. And interesting stuff. But it does point to the fact that thousands of people died working on the railroads every year. The railroads had such a dominant place in American society that the reason we have time zones is because of the railroads. Now, prior to railroads, there was no need for time zones. Every town had its own unique time because noon meant the sun was directly overhead. Well, that's relative. That depends on where you are. But if you don't travel very often, it doesn't matter if your time matches that in New York. It doesn't really matter because you're probably going to spend most of your life in the same geographic area looking at the sun in the same relative position. However, now that railroads are common, and now that people are traveling more, and now that people rely on railroad schedules that they travel by, railroads have to be on time. And so to make this possible, the Earth was divided into 24 time zones. In 1883, the U.S. railroads, along with the United States government, adopted time zones. In fact, at an international conference in 1884, the world agreed to establish time zones, and the world operated, and still does, by railroad time. But here's a picture of Chinese immigrants working on the railroads. And you can see just how dangerous this is by the many different work safety hazards that are in place by this picture.
Phineas Gage was once an ordinary railroad foreman. He was a happy, healthy, and friendly person until a freak accident caused him irreparable brain damage. Now, Gage is remembered as a famous medical mystery. The accident that drastically changed his life and personality also changed contemporary understandings of the human brain. The horrific accident occurred in 1848 when Phineas Gage was clearing rocks from a new railroad's future path. He was placing gunpowder into the cracks in rocks and then detonating them to clear them. One day, he made a mistake with his explosives. Gage forgot to cover the gunpowder he was patting down with sand. When he tried to pat the gunpowder into the rock, it exploded and launched a 3-foot-long metal pole through his skull. The projectile dragged parts of both his frontal lobes along with it. Despite the gruesome injury, Gage was relatively unaffected by the accident. Some reports say that he convulsed for the first minute after the impact, but many believe that he never actually lost consciousness. Regardless, he was undoubtedly conscious about 1 minute after the impact. Gage sat up and actually spoke to his fellow railroad workers. When they wheeled him to a doctor, he insisted on being given his time book to continue doing his job as a foreman. While Gage's determination to continue working despite his terrible injury may seem odd, the effects of his injury were even stranger. The open brain wound healed after only 10 weeks, and Gage was able to count, sing, feed and dress himself, and make sense of information that was given to him. Some aspects of Gage never fully recovered, however. His personality was completely different. His old friends could not tolerate his newly inconsiderate attitude, inexplicable temper, and constant profanity. Soon, he was fired from his job for being nasty to co-workers, people who he had worked well with just 10 weeks before. Gage was so out of control that men kept him away from women and children because he was considered too vulgar for them. Even though he had physically healed, something was still wrong. As his doctor said, Gage was no longer Gage. 11.5 years after the accident, Gage died. Unfortunately for the medical community, no autopsy was conducted on his unique brain. Years later, his body was exhumed with permission from his family, and scientists studied his skull. They saw approximately where the rod traveled through his head, and did their best to understand the damage with their limited understanding of the brain. The case study became an essential part of the debate regarding the function of the brain in the mid-1800s. Two prominent schools of thought existed. Ironically, both used gauge as support for their theory. One group believed that the brain was connected by a vital force. Due to this vital force, any part of the brain could perform any of its functions. Therefore, someone like Gage could still think and behave like everyone else despite having lost a large piece of his brain. The other group of brain theorists, commonly referred to as the localizers, thought that the brain had different parts that localized specific functions. They pointed out that Phineas Gage's personality was never the same after the accident. The localizers believed that the damage to the brain caused the lasting change in Gage's personality. Ultimately, both competing schools of thought were integrated into contemporary brain theory. The brain does have specific localized functions. Modern research has shown that motor functions are certainly localized to specific areas. Localizers, however, underestimated the interconnectedness of the brain. The brain has trillions of synapse connections, and many human functions, such as memory, are impossible to localize to only one area in the brain. Recent studies have shed more light on Phineas Gage's specific condition. Damage to the frontal lobes has been shown to cause behavior spontaneity. Patients with frontal lobe damage often have difficulty interpreting information from their environments, taking risks, and complying with the rules. Especially with injuries that damage both lobes, a person's personality is often drastically altered. These recent studies help explain the effects of Phineas Gage's injury. Still, scientists wish to better understand Gage's disorder and the underlying brain science that could explain it.
But again, the romance of this. You see, the construction of railroads required an enormous amount of materials. Coal production soared because of the steam engines that railroads drove their cars by. The production of steel soared because these rail tracks were made of steel along with the trains themselves. Lumber, of course, the tracks were laid on wooden posts. And so all of these natural resources are going to see a boom in productivity to meet the demand for railroads. Railroads also linked isolated towns. It connected our nation in a way that Henry Clay only could have dreamed of with the American system. It also promoted trade and interdependence. Again, Henry Clay envisioned a country that would be united because we would be connected socially, because we would travel. We would be connected economically because we would do business with one another. And railroads facilitated that in a way that no law could. This allowed towns to specialize in creating certain products. And so you see industrial boom towns sprouting all around the country. You know, just last weekend I was in coal country in West Virginia. And I got to see some of these old coal towns that had boomed and been prosperous during this time of the railroads. But they have long since declined. And these highly impoverished areas are what is left of this industrial boom. Also, new towns entirely grew around railroads, just like they do now around interstates. But now let's talk about some of the powerful people here, the kingpins of their day. One of these was George Pullman, who built a rail car factory in Illinois. Pullman provided a factory town for his workers. The factory owned the doctor's office. The factory owned the housing for the workers. The factory owned the stores the workers shopped in. Even the sporting complexes that the workers played and exercised in. Pullman owned everything in that town. And so he was king of Pullman, Illinois. Now the company placed tight controls on its residents to ensure a stable workforce. These residents were paid not in cash, but in company scrip. So the form of currency was only usable in the company town. It could be exchanged for currency at a loss by the company. And so this was Pullman's way around the 13th Amendment. Yes, he paid his workers. Yes, his workers had the right to quit if they chose. But they were paid in the basic goods they needed to survive. Now, as I said, corruption is embedded in the story of American industrial expansion. Some railroad companies became extremely corrupt. For example, the Union Pacific Railroad. This company formed a construction company called the Credit Mobiler. And they would overbid for construction contracts. And they would keep the profits. So, perhaps a job only cost $100,000. The Credit Mobiler Company would bid $500,000 and they would keep the rest. Now, how would they get away with this? Well, it happens all the time. A company will overbid, they will win the bid because of their connections, and anything they overbid becomes profit for the managers of the company. In fact, this scheme called the Credit Mobiler Scheme was so widespread, the corruption was so enormous, that the Republican Party, leaders of the Republican Party, were implicated in this scandal. And it tarnished the reputation of this party. In fact, some say that even the President of the United States at this time was connected with the Credit Mobiler Scheme. Because if you can pay off top government officials, then you can bid whatever you want and you can keep what you don't need. So next I wanted to show you a picture of some of these rail cars. This is what Pullman made, was a sleeper car. Now, just like any new technology, they would release a better one the next year. And so the next model might have couches or beds. The next model might have electricity. The next model might serve food. And so by innovating, they were able to keep the money flowing in. Next, I wanted to show you what the town looked like. This is the town of Pullman, Illinois. Every home built the same. In all likelihood, the church was built by the factory. In fact, one of these old industrial giants, I believe it was Andrew Carnegie, once said, "Every factory is a temple. A man who works there worships there." And here is the life controlled by the Pullman Company town. Now, many of the railroad companies had become corrupt. And just like the situation in 2008, as the recession was coming into full swing, many of these powerful, wealthy corporations were taking big chances with large amounts of money. And the real victims of their failures were us, the common person. And many became angry over this corruption, just as many of us became angry. I don't know if you've ever seen the movie Big Short, but you need to. It's a great film about how the recession happened. You see, this railroad corruption was hurting the average American. Railroads were selling government lands to businesses, not settlers, and they were bringing in enormous profits. They were fixing prices on transportation of goods. The idea was to keep farmers in debt. In fact, they would often charge farmers higher rates for shipping than they would other customers because they knew they could get away with it. Now, the Farmers Union, founded by Oliver Hudson Kelly, was called the Grange. And the Grange was a movement of the very poor in our country. And they worked to sponsor state
and local political candidates. They represented farmers throughout our country. They pushed for laws to protect farmers' interests. And though the history of the labor movement was often fraught with violence and often the government looked the other way as businesses took advantage of the poor, when people united, the government was forced to pay attention. For example, Munn v. Illinois was the first case where the Supreme Court upheld the right of a state to regulate a private business. And this set the principle that the government, the federal government, can regulate private industry. In fact, Woodrow Wilson, who will later become President of the United States, once said that there can exist no fair trade between the business and the individual without the watchful, resolute interference of the government. And the Supreme Court established that principle here at Munn v. Illinois. Now, the Grange represented a neat opportunity. You see, individually, the farmer was powerless. The farmer was poor. And the farmer was often taken advantage of by companies like the railroads or the banks. For a moment, I want you to think about The Wizard of Oz. It's a fun movie. Everybody likes it. But who does the scarecrow represent? The farmer. I don't know if you've ever thought about this, but the book, The Wizard of Oz, was a parable or an allegory. In fact, each character represented some aspect of the late 19th century American landscape. The scarecrow represented the farmer. He was perceived by the author, Frank Baum, author of Wizard of Oz, he was portrayed as having no brain, as being powerless. Yet together, the farmers could make a difference. You see, here were some of their slogans: no monopolies. Because if one business controls an entire industry, they can charge whatever they want, they can take advantage of people, and no one can do anything about it. Cheap transportation, because farmers relied on this. And then finally, monopolies were opposed to opposition, because the monopolies would fight to keep the power they had. However, it wasn't just the farmers who united. Unions and grassroots organizations all over the country united, pressuring the Supreme Court and the United States Congress to act. And this public outrage eventually led to the Interstate Commerce Act. And if you remember from the end of chapter 13, these grassroots movements became a political party, the Populist Party. And these people, represented by poor Americans all over the country, united around a common cause of making their lives better, of making the government more responsive to their interest. And though William Jennings Bryan lost, their movement saw great success in the long run. You see, the Interstate Commerce Act gave our government the authority to supervise railroads. It also established the Interstate Commerce Commission. However, this would lead to a long legal battle with the railroads, because the railroads by this point were like an octopus. In fact, another author wrote a book called The Octopus, describing Standard Oil, saying how this company had its tentacles in all aspects of American government, and it had control over so many different things. It owned the police, it owned the banks, it owned the courts, it could do anything. And so it's going to be difficult to take down a company that powerful. For example, this man, well, it was another of these cartoons. Thomas Nast drew this of Cornelius Vanderbilt. He's famous in this area. Does anybody know what he's famous for? Yes, Wesley.
The Biltmore House.
The Biltmore House, very good. For building the largest, most extravagant house in all of Western Carolina. That was his vacation home, by the way. He owned the railroads. He's seen here as a puppeteer holding the railroads. This man was so powerful that Pisgah National Forest was his backyard. Literally, he owned Pisgah National Forest. The very first head of the U.S. Forest Service was his groundskeeper, Gifford Pinchot. This man was that powerful. He owned, and by the way, he eventually donated Pisgah National Forest to the public. How did he get that wealthy? Well, of course, the railroads. Now, workers were furious. In the last clip, you just heard about violence between workers and the owners of railroads who would hire thugs to defend their companies with violence. People became so angry, and the government was turning a blind eye, that people became violent to seek basic rights that we now take for granted. You see, the abuses and mismanagement of these large companies and the rampant competition between these huge companies almost bankrupted many of these railroads. And the trouble with this is it's not just some isolated company that we see them close up and it doesn't affect our lives. When a company this big would fail, it would significantly impact the economy. For example, when Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, the two largest banking conglomerates in the United States, almost collapsed in 2008, those two companies almost collapsed the American economy. Now, why did they almost collapse? Well, they almost collapsed because of some shady business dealings that they were doing. And you can watch the movie The Big Short to learn more about it, and we'll get to it later in this class. The scary thing about that is you have companies that are so powerful, they are, quote, too big to fail. And when a company becomes too big to fail, that's very scary because they represent so much power and so much wealth. In fact, these railroads set the precedent for that, because when they struggled financially, that's why we have the Panic of 1893. In fact, by mid-1894, one quarter of all the railroads were taken over by financial holding. I want to begin by telling you the story of a young Scottish immigrant. His name was Andrew Carnegie, and his story has become a bit of a moral tale that people have used to say that anybody can grow up to be somebody in our country. You see, Andrew Carnegie came here to this country with next to nothing. He immigrated here with his family from Ireland, and he went to work in a factory from a very young age. And he took a little bit out of each check and he invested it in stock in the company that he worked for. In fact, by the time he was a young man, he owned the company that he worked for. He was very clever. He was a very hard worker. Now, by the time he was my age, he owned many of the companies that made steel in his area. And by the time that he retired, he owned all of the companies that made steel. In fact, he created U.S. Steel, which is still the country's leading producer in steel. Now the question is, how did he do it? How did this young man who came here penniless grow up to be one of the richest men that has ever lived in the history of our country? Well, number one, he was always searching for ways to make better products more cheaply, and that's just good business. That's just innovation. He hired very talented people to work for him. He would offer his employees stock in the company, giving them a sense of ownership. And he would promote competition among his employees. In fact, of all the methods I've tried to use to get you guys to make good projects, I believe that competition, that friendly competition of just encouraging you guys to make better content, has made those projects more fun but it's also inspired you to make better stuff. And really, that's how a good workplace operates. Friendly competition amongst employees. Now, here's where things get a little shady. Perhaps you could call it clever. Perhaps you might call it sketchy. Carnegie realized that he could vertically integrate his business by buying up and controlling all the means of production. If he cut out the middlemen, he could make his product the way he wanted, and he could make his product cheaper. For example, my smartphone obsession is becoming unhealthy, it really is, but Google recently released the Pixel. Now, previously, all the Nexus devices were made by a third-party company. A number of different companies, either the one with the H, or HTC, or a number of different companies have been producing Google's devices for them. But just this year, Google vertically integrated their production line by manufacturing phones themselves. Now, they still relied on a third-party company, HTC, to do the production. However, Google maintained control over production of the device from top to bottom, software and hardware. Now, in order for them to vertically integrate, they would have to actually build a production facility, and instead of contracting with HTC, who is in Taiwan, they would have to produce the device themselves. Then, they would have to distribute the device. We don't see Google stores yet. I mean, you can buy them from their website. So in some ways, they have vertically integrated, but not yet entirely. Now, you see, that's what Carnegie was able to do. He purchased the mines that dug up the iron, the refineries that turned that iron into steel, the distribution, the trucks that brought that iron to the retailers, and then finally, he even owned many of the retailers who would sell that steel to contractors and construction workers. One could argue that's brilliant, but this is also a tool that industries would use to build monopolies. The next one is horizontal integration. I don't know if you've heard about the Time Warner merger. It's an $85 billion merger of two major media conglomerates. In fact, AT&T and Time Warner recently merged, forming one of the largest media companies. Now, again, horizontal integration is a form of merger. That means that competing companies, such as Time Warner and AT&T, will join together to form one company. You see, since you've been growing up, it feels like YouTube has been out forever. But YouTube was once owned by a different company than Google. Google had its own video streaming service called Google Video. It wasn't doing very well. I remember it. It was poor quality video, no one posted content to it, and so it wasn't widely used. But Google, one of the most powerful technology conglomerates in the world, bought YouTube. They couldn't compete with it, so they bought it. And it led many to become concerned that Google would become a monopoly. That's exactly what Andrew Carnegie did. When he formed U.S. Steel, he bought out all of his competition. And again, by the time that he sold his business to J.P. Morgan, he was controlling the entire U.S. steel industry. Next. How does one justify that massive accumulation of wealth? We're talking about the ultra-billionaires here. How do they justify their practices? You know, how does someone justify unethical practices that allow them to rise to the top. In the late 1800s, Charles Darwin published The Origin of Species, detailing his theory of natural selection and evolution of species. And Darwin said that species survive through competition. And this natural competition leaves behind the weak. And for example, if there is a famine in a population of deer, the strongest deer will survive, but the weakest ones will die. And in a severe famine, the weakest ones will die before they reach an age where they can reproduce. And Darwin would argue, while cruel, that leads to a stronger species of deer in the long run. And that natural selection has been the process by which we have evolved from lesser species. If you take that theory and apply it to society, and you consider that the weakest in society will die off through a process of natural selection, then you can just call it a dog-eat-dog world and the weakest of the wolves and shrug your shoulders about it. And that's what many did. It's called social Darwinism. It's the idea, based on Darwin's theory, that those ultra-billionaires consider themselves superior to the rest of us. And they justify their practices based on natural selection. The idea here is that the most capable people will rise to the top, that the Carnegies of the world will become the leaders of this world because they are the most ruthless. And while many saw that as justified, especially the wealthy, especially those who were controlling the flow of media at this time, you see, the notion of individual responsibility is in line with the Protestant work ethic. You know, Hoover called it rugged individualism. The idea that you stand or fall on your own, and if you are successful, then you must have been successful on your own merits. And that's social Darwinism. In fact, this theory maintains that the wealthy must not only have possessed superior genetic traits, but in a Christian ethos, would be more blessed by God. Now that, in terms of, you know, the odd thing is that this has become accepted in evangelical circles, and yet it completely neglects the idea of the Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 6, where Jesus talks about the meek inheriting the earth. But again, it's this idea of survival of the fittest. Now here's the scary part. This idea also maintains that the poor must be inferior. Now as a teacher, this idea bothers me. And this goes against everything that I'm working for in my career. But some use this to justify turning their backs on the poor. And I've got a clip to illustrate. First off, I just wanted to show you a working class neighborhood. You know, this was where the poor lived in the late 1800s, early 1900s, in dirty, filthy slums. And what Lyndon Johnson later argued by announcing his war on poverty is that survival of the fittest doesn't really work if everyone doesn't have an equal opportunity to succeed. You see, if you didn't have a safe place to sleep last night, I've had students who surf couches. You've known people who serve couches. If you don't have a safe place to sleep at night, then you're going to be too tired to get much out of school that next day. And you're going to be too tired in the long run to work hard and be successful. And if your afternoons are filled with obligations, while your classmates' afternoons are free to do homework and socialize and have fun, then perhaps you don't have an equal opportunity. Perhaps someone living here is going to have a much more difficult time rising to the top than someone with a bit of luxury.
Karl Marx, Andrew Carnegie, Joseph Stalin, John D. Rockefeller, Adolf Hitler. What do these men have in common? From capitalists to communists, all found, in a misinterpretation of Darwin, justification for the conduct of their lives. They seized on a phrase Darwin never used, survival of the fittest, and used it to rationalize attitudes and actions that affected the course of modern history.
In the late 19th century, there was a whole school of thought, or perhaps several schools of thought, which now are known as social Darwinism, which really used evolution as an underwriting of a fairly crude kind of competitive ethic in society, what we might call a free market ethic, but more than that, the notion of dog eat dog, the weakest to the wall, and the phrase that Darwin's contemporary Herbert Spencer actually used for natural selection, which was survival of the fittest.
But Spencer thought evolution had a direction, from simple to complex, from inferior to superior. Darwin's version of the theory was not survival of the fittest. It could be better paraphrased as survival of those best adapted.
Well, the master race idea, from which we think of in connection with the 30s and with Germany, in some senses was the low point in the whole attempt to apply evolutionary and biological thinking to human affairs, because that's to turn a scientific theory into a moral statement or even a political statement, which of course it is not.
The Nazis taught that Jews were evolutionary throwbacks. The Aryan race, they said, was the pinnacle of evolution, and maintaining racial purity was an evolutionary obligation.
Well, it wasn't just Hitler who thought about the idea of applying biological ideas in a rather radical way to
Now, again, that's just a theory that was underpinning many of these practices. Some carried this theory to extremes, like the Nazis, and would say that certain races were superior genetically to other races. And if you carry that idea to its logical conclusion, then you begin to think of some humans as less human than others. And the Nazis would use that to justify their practices. Now, businesses. Many businesses exist for the purpose of making money. Some are in it for the love, but many are in it to make money. And perhaps the most effective way to make money is to control that particular industry. You know, Apple and Google are rather excited about the failure of the Note 7, because that removes one big piece of their competition. And either company would be thrilled with the possibility of the destruction of the other, because that would remove all competition. And that's what many businesses sought to do. They could do this by merging with competing companies, like Google purchasing YouTube, or buying out competitors. Walmart has maintained a practice of underselling their competition for many, many decades. And this has resulted in the failure and bankruptcy of Kmart. And of course, that's a victory for Walmart, because that removes one big piece of their competition. Hostile takeovers are where a holding company buys up all the stock of another company. If you control 51% of the shares of a publicly traded company, then you have the controlling share. You effectively run the company. And this can help create monopolies. Now, one of the most successful monopolists in history, in fact, this man is by and far the wealthiest man in the history of the world. If we put his money in today's dollars, he had almost $300 billion in his personal wealth. That was John D. Rockefeller, owner of Standard Oil. And so he used these practices of vertical integration, horizontal integration, hostile takeovers, buying out competition. But yet he was able to get around the Sherman Antitrust Act. You see, he operated a monopoly. He controlled 90% of the world's oil production at a time when the United States was the leading producer of oil. He had trustees run separate companies, but yet they were all controlled by Rockefeller. And this was his way around the Sherman Antitrust Act. Had he ruled all of these companies directly, that would be an obvious monopoly. But if he had people whom he trusted run separate companies under his direction, he had found a loophole. Now, Rockefeller and Carnegie and many others earned the name robber barons. But it's really a matter of perspective. Some called them robber barons. Some called them captains of industry, because these leaders in their industries produced innovation, created jobs, and even in many cases gave back large amounts of money to the poor. But the question we have to ask ourselves is, how did these people become so immensely wealthy? Well, partly it was by keeping profit margins high by paying their workers very poorly. You know, again, how is Walmart able to sell their products so cheaply? And maybe you don't even buy from Walmart, maybe you buy from Amazon. How is Amazon able to keep their products so cheap? Well, part of it, sure, is by avoiding the middleman of brick and mortar retailer. But a big part of it also is by paying their employees very low wages, and by underselling the competition. Because Walmart will match any competitor's price, period. And you know we all do it. You know, yesterday I was out with my wife, we were walking around Brevard and we were shopping and looking at clothes. I do need to buy some new clothes eventually. And we were looking at some pants and shirts. And of course the store we walked into, Rockies and Brevard, was kind of expensive. You know, and so I was looking at the stickers, like, oh, I can't really afford that. And she was like, just take pictures of stuff and we'll look it up online later. We all do that, right?
No.
Yes. You know, we do that. It may not be the most ethical thing, but we do. You know, you walk through the store, it gives you a chance to see something for yourself, and you're like, well, I'll shop for the cheaper price online. Well, I don't know how much Rockies pays their employees, but I can tell you part of the reason they have to charge more is simply the rent on the building. And then paying those employees to watch the store and help with purchases, etc. Amazon can undercut all of that. And when they control the market, they can raise prices. Now, critics call these industrialists robber barons. But to help their image, these people give back large amounts of wealth to the poor and become philanthropists. But eventually, the government was forced to realize that these expanding corporations are stifling free competition. For example, Windows has long passed its heyday as the dominant operating system, though it is still the primary operating system used in the workplace. I mean, this is a Windows device. I bet many of your computers are Windows devices. In 1995, when Windows released Windows 95, it was so dominant that Microsoft was charged under the Sherman Antitrust Act for building a monopoly. And so they had to release their Windows that year as a separate company because they were that powerful. And so the Sherman Antitrust Act makes monopolies illegal if they interfere with free trade. However, prosecuting these companies proved rather difficult, eventually to the point where the government stopped enforcing this law. But here's the scary thought. If you have someone, or if you have a corporation with that much money, for example, the Koch brothers promised to spend $1 billion on this election. Why do you think they would spend $1 billion on an election? I mean, what do they have to get from it? And you can study that because it's a matter of public record. What returns are they getting on their investment? I can assure you they are making that money back many times over. It's a form of bribery. And with that much money, the concern was that Standard Oil could control a government. Now, this business boom, this industrial boom, in fact, I believe it was Mark Twain called it the Gilded Age. It essentially bypassed the South because the South was still recovering from the Civil War. There wasn't a lot of private investment. A lot of companies weren't moving to the South at this time. The North owned 90% of stock in railroads in the South, which was the most profitable Southern business. So many of the profits from private businesses in the South were still going back to the North. There were several business problems in the South. The cost of high transport because of the lack of good transportation infrastructure, tariffs because of imports, and then finally there were very few skilled workers in the South because there wasn't a lot of educational opportunities in the South at that time. But now let's think of the person, the worker. Northern wages were generally higher than Southern. However, workers had to face unsafe conditions in dark and dangerous factories. And because of these unsafe conditions and because of the unfair treatment of workers, many eventually organized. You see, workers would have to pull 12-hour days. 12-hour days. And I know that school doesn't feel that exciting right now. And I know there are things you would rather be doing. But I want you to realize how much better this is than a 12-hour day in a dark, dangerous factory doing a mindless, repetitive task. And you had no opportunities for vacation, no opportunities for sick leave. If you were hurt, you better go back to work because they can fire you. And they don't even have to justify why they fire you. There was a case of, in a matchmaking industry, and I'm not talking about a dating service, I'm talking about making matches. You see, these matches used to have to be dipped by hand into a chemical called phosphorus. Ask Mr. Savage, phosphorus is a dangerous substance, highly combustible. The least static discharge can cause an explosion. There was a case of a woman whose arm was blown off in an explosion caused by a static discharge. And Carly, this woman was told that she had to either go back to work without an arm or lose her job. Making hats. See, top hats were the rage at that time. Making hats was also a dangerous occupation. If you've watched Alice in Wonderland, you've heard the story of the Mad Hatter. Now, the Mad Hatter was a Mad Hatter because the chemicals they would dip the hats in to give them their firm shape caused insanity. And the workers had no protection for their respiratory system. So they were inhaling these dangerous chemicals all day, every day, and they would eventually go mad. The coal mining industry. Most coal miners never lived past their early 50s because they would spend all day in dark tunnels breathing in the dust of coal. And when they became too sick to work, they were laid off. To survive, all members of a family had to work, including children and women who often found work in sweatshops, because these were the only jobs available for women and children, and they would pay terrible wages and long hours. Now, if you worked in an environment like this, you wouldn't have many options. It's work or get fired, work or starve. There's no social safety net. Even under those circumstances, workers organized. So the first large-scale national union, the National Labor Union, formed in 1868, went on strike, even though companies retained the right to fire these striking workers for any reason. And often, they would hire thugs to go and beat up striking workers if they showed up outside their factory. Can you imagine Chase being forced to work in an environment where if you quit, no one cared? And if you tried to push for better rights, someone's going to come and beat you up and threaten your family. I just want you to understand and be happy for what you have, because people died to make that happen. Just like the rights that you have as an American, people died for those. We all get to appreciate those. But sometimes we don't realize that people fought for the rights that we have as workers, such as the 8-hour workday. That's something the National Labor Union worked for, petitioned Congress. But one of the troubles is unskilled workers have very little bargaining power because they're easily replaceable. However, skilled workers, such as the American Federation of Labor, founded by Samuel Gompers, was able to use collective bargaining for better wages, better working hours, better conditions. They were able to go on strike, and because they represented skilled workers, they were much harder to replace. And they were able to win standards for higher pay and a shorter work week. Many industrial unions formed. For example, Eugene Debs, who would go on to run for president for 4 consecutive attempts. In fact, one of those was running from prison. This movement became rather violent because these companies, when you control an entire industry and your workers go on strike, owners will view it in the way that governments view a rebellion. And they will call out the National Guard, who are often on the payroll of these managers. And they will call out hired thugs, mercenaries. Eugene Debs was actually arrested and ran for prison while in jail. Received 10% of the popular vote when he ran for presidency while in jail. Anybody know why he was in jail? You see, he protested the draft in the First World War because he disagreed with a law forcing people to fight for what he saw as industrial interest, profits of war industries. And many concluded that he was right. See these strikes that we're about to begin looking at?
Hey, Crutchy.
Open the gates and seize the day. Don't be afraid and don't delay. Nothing can
can break us. No one can make us give our rights away. Arise and seize the day. Time to seize the day.
Now is the time to seize the day.
Send out the call and join the fray.
Send out the call and join the fray.
Bronx will be riding if we're united.
Let us seize the day.
Friends of the friendless, seize the day.
Friends of the friendless, seize the day.
Raise up the torch and light the way.
Raise up the torch and light the way. Proud and defiant, we'll slay the giant. Let us seize.
In many cases became violent.
When a people are downtrodden to a point, they will stand up for themselves.
And some labor activists turned to socialism. This is the philosophy that the government should control business and place high regulations on private business, that there should be an equal distribution of wealth. And that's the more extreme version of socialism versus democratic socialism, which maybe you heard about in this election. A lot more moderate. But now, the industrial workers of the world were a labor union formed in 1905 that at their peak represented 200,000 workers. They advocated communism. That's why they called themselves the workers of the world, because Karl Marx said, "Workers of the world, unite." And Karl Marx was the author of communism. Now, immigrant laborers also found themselves caught up in labor movements, such as Japanese and Mexican immigrants, and farm laborers in the Southwest, Chinese immigrants, and many people. The idea was that workers uniting can give us these rights that we now take for granted. But again, these are rights that people have fought for. Have been beaten for. See, these are National Guardsmen called to attack striking workers. Several cases here. The Great Strike of 1877, the B&O Railroad strike, spread to all other lines and became an industry-wide railroad strike. The government said that this was impending interstate commerce, and they sent federal troops to disperse the striking workers. You see, under the Wagner Act now, you have the right to go on strike. One of the most violent was called the Haymarket Affair. 3,000 striking workers gathered at Chicago's Haymarket Square to protest police brutality. When violence ensued and people were killed, 8 were charged and arrested with inciting a riot. And the media spun this, saying that the striking workers were communists and threatening the safety and security of our country. Another one of these cases, the Homestead Strike. Carnegie Steel workers struck over pay cuts, and they had to fight a battle against hired thugs called the Pinkerton Detective Agency. The National Guard was sent to forcibly reopen the plant. Soldiers ran the plant for a period of time. In fact, after this strike, steel workers were not able to mobilize once more for another 45 years. Then we have the Pullman Company strike. Pullman in Illinois, the company making railroad cars, laid off 3,000 people, cut wages of those who remained, but kept rent the same, all in a bid to keep profits high. Pullman refused to negotiate with the striking workers. It became violent. Again, federal troops were sent in. Eugene Debs, leading the strike, was put in jail. Most of the workers in the entire plant were fired. Many were blacklisted, meaning they would never be able to find jobs again. And so here's a drawing from the Pullman strike. Women also organized. One of the most famous women labor leaders was a woman named Mary Harris Jones. She worked for the United Mine Workers. In fact, she led a march of children, the children of workers who had been downtrodden in peaceful civil disobedience. But perhaps of all the things in the labor movement, sadly, sometimes it takes a tragedy. In 1911, a factory making shirts caught on fire. There were hundreds of women working in this factory in New York. And when it burned to the ground, there were almost 200 women trapped on the eighth floor, the main production line. Because there was no fire escape, well, the one that was there collapsed when people tried to use it. And there was only one door allowing exit from that floor. And it was designed in a way that it could only be opened by a manager. And so the women were trapped and they burned alive because the only route of escape could only be opened by a manager. They were literally locked in there like prisoners. And when these women burned, it was found out how they were being treated. Many employers forbid the formation of unions. And the law generally worked against the worker. However, workers continued. But here's the tragic story of the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire.